And it is also true that the campaign is spontaneous, it's grassroots, and we as a campaign don't have control of it, and that is great because it is such a crucial issue and idea. It's just delightful to see so many joining us in doing what they have to do. So this is to me very, very encouraging that it is happening. But what it has really done, it has taken us as individuals and brought us together to the point for the very first time, I believe, as almost ever, where we were able to compete with the special interests. The special interests control our government on both sides. The big money goes in, and all the PACs and the political action committees, and they just pour hundreds of millions of dollars into the other campaigns. This time, we don't have the money that they have, but we have a significant enough amount of money that we can compete. We have this secret weapon, which is a political equalizer, that is the internet, bringing the people together, and I am so glad that you have been able to do that so spontaneously. Right now, there are supposed to be, I think, over 1,300 meetup groups, and they seem to grow every single day, and the support is out there. The big question is, are we going to be able to put it all together in a short time, in 6 weeks here in this state? Can we get the people there to vote? Because we have proven ourselves. We have proven ourselves with the number of volunteers and the money raised and the excitement that we have. But ultimately, the only test that really counts is the voting. And we are working hard. We are spending the money that has been donated up in New Hampshire, in this state, and in Iowa and Nevada. So the early primaries are going to be, we're going to be concentrating on those. And there's every reason to in the world to be optimistic. I'm long-term optimist. I've generally been short-term pessimist. I was more pessimistic, you know, just 12 months ago, because I was arguing with myself and with my wife and my supporters who wanted me to run. I said, well, I don't think it's ready yet. We've been working a long time for the freedom movement to get more people engaged and more people educated. And then all of a sudden I said, well, okay, I'm going to try it, but I don't know how big the remnant is. Nobody's been able to count the remnant, but maybe it is bigger than I think. And then, lo and behold, the remnant is much bigger than I thought. But the other great thing is not only was there a remnant out there that knew and understood and believed, but possibly had dropped out of the political process, but the young people, the way they respond on principle to the Constitution and to this message, that's what we're really enjoying. But it is a great event, and it's very important, and we have to deal with all our problems. One of the major problems we're facing right now is the idea of national sovereignty and our border situation. We don't need to be worrying about the borders between Iraq and Syria. We need to be worrying about our borders around our own country. We literally have sent border guards to Iraq to train other border guards. I would say that we have a better use for border guards right here at home. That is a responsibility of the federal government. But once again, we do the things we're not supposed to be doing, and we forget about the things that we're supposed to do here at home. But, you know, I have worked real hard on trying to protect our national sovereignty, because each and every year, ever since I've been in Congress, I always introduced the legislation that would get us out of the United Nations. But it's very expensive, and it hurts our sovereignty when we're in the United Nations, the IMF, the World Bank, and when we get joined NAFTA and CAFTA. And now we are dedicated to eliminating or prevent this North American Union from being established. But one of the reasons why we have a lot of illegal immigrants coming into this country is we subsidize them. We give them easy road to citizenship, we reward them there, and we tell them, well, if you bring your families, the federal government forces the states to provide free medical care and free education. They can get food stamps, they can qualify for Social Security, they can have birthright citizenship. So I would say that it's time no more subsidies for illegal immigrants, and that we make sure that it, when immigrants come here, that they are legal immigrants. And if we had a healthier economy, this would not be nearly the problem that we have today. But when we see our good jobs going overseas, we see inflation here, we see Americans have a difficult time paying their bills, waiting in line in emergency rooms, or seeing the food stamps in the grocery stores, and then all of a sudden this becomes combative. And it's very, very unnecessary. What we need, though, is an obvious return to sound economic policies. We need a return to sound fiscal policy, as well as a sound foreign policy. In a time of war, there's this tendency for Americans and other countries, all citizens, to give up their liberties when there's fear in the land. At war, people think, well, it's wartime, we have to sacrifice our liberties. After 9/11, you know, people thought, well, we have to do something, giving up our freedoms, no big deal. Well, I think it is a big deal. I don't think we ever should give up any part of our freedoms for the sake of security. Matter of fact, it's my belief that if we had had a better understanding of property rights in the Second Amendment, it would be quite possible that 9/11 might not have ever happened. But ultimately, these changes will come because of the financial conditions that we have. We have to emphasize the importance of our freedoms. We have to understand that our lives and our freedoms come from our Creator. They do not come from our government. The government is there to protect them, not to pretend that they should be the nanny state and be our parents. But today we have accepted the role of government to tell us everything that we must do, and anything we eat, drink, smoke, it's only going to be under the government's rules and regulations. They have rules and regulations on everything that we do. We now have a move on for the WTO to take over the control of the vitamins and nutritional substances, and I'd say stay out of that. We don't need that. But we also don't need a powerful central government to deal with the government that we do need. If we have a need for government, and we do, we should have that government local. We don't need management from Washington. The typical example of the efficiency of government was the example they set after Katrina when they went down to rescue New Orleans. Not very successful. So it is much better for us to think about local controls, not central economic planning in Washington, because it's wasteful and it is unconstitutional, because these problems were supposed to be dealt with at the local level.